The way I became acquainted with this whole exotic idea of transhumanism, I was doing research, actually. I was a writer and doing research for one of the largest U.S. newspapers out of Oklahoma. And this is maybe 20-some years ago. And doing research on the history of Halloween, of all things, and somewhere I came across a term that I had never seen before called transgenics. Now, I didn't know what transgenics was, but you know, I could kind of put two and two together. Trans, genes, that somehow we're talking here about genetic engineering, the altering of genes. And I became fascinated with this idea because back then the science was brand new. It was not, you know, biotechnology, nanotechnology. These were not even terms that existed. But it was following on the heels of the mapping of the human genome, which then was giving both the birth to a promise and also to the sciences that we are going to be able to do things with genetics. We'll be able to heal our bodies, we'll be able to make ourselves stronger. There was a great deal of promise that was emerging quickly, and the science to back it up, at least in theory. And so I started doing research into transgenics, and at the time it wasn't very easy to get information. The internet was brand new. Certainly the science wasn't old enough for there to be much, you know, that had been published in peer-reviewed journals. And I wanted to know what is the good and what is the bad and what is transgenics. And I came to understand that transgenics was simply the crossing over of species barriers. This could be done at the level of just organisms. This could be done all the way up to the level of sentient beings, that you could literally blend one kind of a creature with another creature. Why would we want to do that? What would be the purpose behind it? That was what motivated me. And quickly I began to realize that both the military and also the pharmaceutical industry both had an interest in transgenics. The military because they thought they might be able to create exotic new forms of materials that could be used. For instance, one of the first successes was a project that was funded by DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, in which they created transgenic goat spiders, actually spider goats. And the reason that they did this was because they knew that spider silk is amazingly resilient, lightweight, but very strong. And yet it's not very easy, you know, to create a spider farm where you can milk spiders for their silk. But they knew that they could do this with goats. And so that one of the first successes in transgenics was creating a goat which was part spider. It could actually grow spider silk in its milk. And then they could use this for making lightweight bulletproof vests. They could use it for creating cargo nets. But since that time until now, as we may discover later on in this discussion, it has become far more sophisticated in terms of the military's interest and the amount of dollars that are flowing into research that grew out of those early forms of transgenic science. On the other side of transgenics, which is probably the biggest part of where the funding is coming from today, is in the pharmaceutical industry. Pharmaceuticals, why? Because the industry often has to labor with the FDA to try to get permission to do testing of new drug therapies on human subjects. It's very daunting, that task, to try to get a promising new remedy potentially for some kind of debilitating disease, and then to be able to take and start trying that medicine, which is unproven, on human test subjects is not easy to do. Well, the pharmaceutical industry saw right away that they would be able to take animals and put human DNA into the animals, create a human-animal chimera, and then they could work around this problem with getting permission from federal agencies to do human experimentation, and now they could test new drugs in human-animal chimeras to see how the human elements of that creature might respond in a way that they're hoping for with these drug therapies.
The means to edit the genome of a human embryo already exist, though the technology is still in its early stages. But it has already been attempted twice. In 2015 and 2016, Chinese scientists experimented with human embryos and were partially successful on their second attempt. They showed the enormous challenges we still face in gene editing embryos, but also that scientists are working on solving them. This is like the computer in the 70s. There will be better computers. Regardless of your personal take on genetic engineering, it will affect you. Modified humans could alter the genome of our entire species because their engineered traits will be passed on to their children and could spread over generations, slowly modifying the whole gene pool of humanity. It will start slowly. The first designer babies will not be overly designed. It's most likely that they will be created to eliminate a deadly genetic disease running in a family. As the technology progresses and gets more refined, more and more people may argue that not using genetic modification is unethical because it condemns children to preventable suffering and death and denies them the cure. But as soon as the first engineered kid is born, a door is opened that can't be closed anymore. Early on, vanity traits will mostly be left alone. But as genetic modification becomes more accepted and our knowledge of our genetic code enhances, the temptation will grow. If you make your offspring immune to Alzheimer, why not also give them an enhanced metabolism? Why not throw in perfect eyesight? How about height or muscular structure? Full hair? How about giving your child the gift of extraordinary intelligence? Huge changes are made as a result of the personal decisions of millions of individuals that accumulate. This is a slippery slope. Modified humans could become the new standard. But as engineering becomes more normal and our knowledge improves, we could solve the single biggest mortality risk factor, aging. 2/3 of the 150,000 people who die today will die of age-related causes. Currently, we think aging is caused by the accumulation of damage to our cells, like DNA breaks and the systems responsible for fixing those wearing off over time. But there are also genes that directly affect aging. A combination of genetic engineering and other therapy could stop or slow down aging, maybe even reverse it. We know from nature that there are animals immune to aging. Maybe we could even borrow a few genes for ourselves.
The Birkbeck Law School in Britain is one of the most famous law schools on earth for teaching CSI students, crime scene investigators. And they put out a press release about 18 months ago now in which they said that they will need to design future classes for crime scene analysis which has been perpetrated by something that is only part human. The whole point was that everything we know about forensics, about profiling, might not apply if we're trying to track down a serial rapist who is part wolf, because he may have a bloodlust, he may have a difference, his mindset, his instincts, everything about him may not fit anything that we understand. And this is considered to be such a real possibility, by the way. It isn't just the Birkbeck Law School. This last year in California, a House Foreign Affairs Committee hearing in the state of California that was chaired by Democrat Brad Sherman, who's actually best known for his expertise in the spread of nuclear arms among terrorists, chaired this meeting. A writer for Congressional Quarterly, Mark Stenzel, attended the meeting and came out of it flabbergasted because what the meeting was all about is future terrorism conducted by transhumans. And he said that the entire hearing, a congressional hearing, he said sounded more like a pitch for a sci-fi movie than it did a sober discussion of scientific reality, because he said they were talking about superhumans, super intelligence, artificial intelligence, and super animals that could soon be on the battlefield or even in our neighborhoods for domestic reasons, a lethal force for which we are not prepared.
That's Punch and Judy. They've always been violent.
But Punch and Judy,
that's good. It's good. It's a good aggressive behavior.
Better than my act?
I just want to watch you up until right now.
I was going to bite you very badly.
Get the door!
I'll get it.
I made a song for tonight, but you said balls.
All right. Hold your horses. All right already.
Gentlemen.
It was a birth announcement that shocked the world.
Two beautiful little Chinese girls named Lulu and Lala came crying into the world as healthy as any other babies a few weeks ago.
Chinese biophysicist He Zhangqi, working largely in secret, had used CRISPR to knock out a gene called CCR5 in two early human embryos, then returned the embryos to their mother's womb. CCR5 plays a key role in HIV infection, and the girl's father was HIV positive. He said his motive was noble.
As a father of two girls, I can't think of a gift more beautiful and wholesome for the society than giving another couple a chance to start a loving family.
But the scientific community did not cheer. At the International Summit on Human Genome Editing that He attended shortly after the announcement, the reaction was shock and condemnation.
I understand my work will be controversial, but I believe family need this technology, and I'm willing to take the criticism for this.
One thing I know, it's female stats. I mean, anything bigger than a handful, you're risking a sprained toe, you know, and...
Yeah.
Yeah. Perfect.
Okay, now what?
Should we give her a brain?
Yeah, we can play chess with her.
Chess? Just give her a brain, okay? Okay, Phil, what the hell
scars
is this?
Scars that would take months to heal. Scars that would be permanently evident. Healed in 18 hours without a trace.
I mean, his internal organs heal faster than that once we increase the dosage. We have the x-rays, you could see them. I mean, he's got the internal organs of a 20-year-old boy.
Watch this.
That again. Oh my gosh.
We increased the dosage to 5 million units per hour. The natural healing process has been accelerated until it is almost immediate.
He's still on life support, though, right?
Oh, is he? We have living proof that our formula works. Think of it, Tom. Bones will mend, wounds will heal, diseases cured. Now tell me, isn't that worth everything? Anything?
Yeah. Look, before we go to Stockholm and pick up the Nobel Prizes, I want them through the whole works, okay?
Sure.
Now, Philip.
That used to be our patient's genetic structure.
Uh-huh. Okay, let's see what it looks like now. Complete.
completely altered, right?
What are you talking about? That's as beautiful a genetic structure as anything created by nature.
Mm-hmm. And as grotesque as anything created by man.
What'd you expect, huh?
I don't know.
Well, I mean, you can't expect to interpret behavior from genetic structure.
Oh, come on, Paul. We start with a social mutant to begin with.
Look, what difference does it make? Look at that structure.
No. I've been expecting you. Come in. I did it, John. I made history. We did it. And I'm the only one left who knows how we did it.